Preacher, Volume 4, Ancient History, written by Garth Ennis, art by Steve Pugh, Carlos Esquerza, and Richard Case.
Okay, so this volume of Preacher is unlike all the other volumes of Preacher. Jesse Tulip and Cassidy are not in this volume at all. Series regular artist Steve Dillon is not doing any of the artwork. This volume is just a whole bunch of short stories about secondary characters. So there are three stories in this book. The first one, and easily the best one, is about the Saint of Killers and his origin. So that guy is such a badass. It's very interesting to learn about his whole backstory. The next story is about Assface, aka Eugene, and we learn what caused him to shoot himself. So that's interesting. And the last story is completely pointless, and it's not an origin at all. It's just a fun adventure about Jody and TC. It's not the best story, but there are some definite funny moments in it. All right, let's dive into Volume 4, Ancient History. Saint of Killers number 1 and 2. This mini-series opens in the Old West, the time of gunslingers. The Saint of Killers was then just a normal human man. He fought in the Civil War on the side of the Confederacy and was known as one of the most violent, bloodthirsty soldiers on the battlefield, killing dozens of men. His reputation grew, and even after the war, he was feared, not only by the people he had fought against and alongside, but by people who'd only heard of his legend. When the war ended, the gunslinger went west, back to Texas. He stayed apart from other people and made his money getting the bounties on Indian scalps. The gunslinger saw his share of men's cruelty and had resigned himself to the fact that mankind was a corrupt, savage race. He didn't think there was any hope, either for America or for himself, until he met her. While hunting some Apache Indians, he came across a young blonde woman. She begged the gunslinger not to shoot her. He offered to give her a ride into the nearby town of Laredo, a couple days from here. That is where he is headed. Later that night, when they are camping, she explains to the gunslinger that she was held captive by the Indians and claims they were going to do terrible things to her. She says they were savages. The gunslinger says, "In our hearts, we're as savage as they are. Indians and whites ain't but two tribes of butchers fighting over a stretch of dirt. What we'll decide in the end is who's meanest." The woman says, "But you yourself, you rescued me from 5 Indians, single-handed and without a thought for your own safety." But the gunslinger admits, "I didn't know you were there. As to decency, I crept up and shot them in the back when they were too damn drunk to fight." They finally arrive in the town of Laredo, and the girl is returned to her family, to her brother. Her brother is shocked when his sister points out the gentleman that saved her. The brother, he knows the gunslinger's legend. He tells his sister, "That man? That's the one that saved you? He's a butcher. He's as bad as Satan himself. He's killed every man he's run across, and he got a taste for it during the war. He's a bounty hunter, and he always gets who he's after, and he drinks and shoots men in taverns who look at him wrong." And the girl says, "Well, he didn't kill me," and she wants to go back with him. There's not much for her here in town, and she saw that beneath the gunslinger's cold, cynical skin lies a good man, or at least the potential for one. She wanted to make it her mission to find the goodness in him, to take a man who had given up all hope of humanity and show him that there was good in life after all. She asks the gunslinger if she can tag along with him, and the gunslinger warns her that he's a dangerous man and killing is all he knows, but she wants to go with him anyway. They end up being together for about a decade and fall in love, and they even have a child together, a baby daughter. They all live together in the wild, living off the land, happy. For the first time, the gunslinger felt satisfaction and knew that there was actually more to his life than killing. He had a family and a future. But then,
His wife and daughter got sick with a fever, and they were bedridden, and the only medicine was a week away by horse. It pained the gunslinger, but he had to leave his family behind and go get that medicine. And his wife told him, go, hurry, but, and this was important, she told the gunslinger, if he didn't make it, if anything should happen before he got back, not to blame himself. It would be the fever's fault, not his. But he pledged to get the medicine and get back in time. So the gunslinger took off to get the medicine, riding into a blizzard. He eventually arrived in the town of Ratwater. He went to see the doctor to get the medicine, but the doctor was too drunk to stand and said, come back in the morning. So reluctantly, the gunslinger had to take up lodgings for the night. He slept and he worried about his family throughout the entire night. In the morning, the gunslinger returned to the doctor, who's now not drunk anymore, and the doctor says the medicine will take him about an hour or two to prepare. So the gunslinger should go get breakfast and come back, and the doctor should have it ready by then. The gunslinger says he would appreciate the doctor hurrying. He is intending on leaving directly after. The doctor warns that that is not a good idea. The blizzard is going to return into town. The gunslinger says he still plans on leaving anyway. So the gunslinger has to kill some time while the doctor creates the medicine. So he goes and grabs some supplies and heads to the saloon for breakfast. But then a gang comes in. This gang of men are led by a man named Gumbo McCready. Gumbo is the leader of a band of Texas thugs. And Gumbo, he was a man who led other men simply by being crueler and more murderous than anyone else. The blizzard caused the gang to change course, so they wound up here in Ratwater. Now Gumbo and his men scan the saloon, and they notice the gunslinger sitting at the back, and that he don't look like no local. So one of McCready's men, a corrupt preacher, thinks that he recognizes this gunslinger sitting at the back, but he can't place him. One of the younger men in the gang asks Gumbo, want me to ask him what he's doing? And the other man in the gang cheer on the young man and tell him that's a good idea. Why don't you go talk to that fella? So the young gang member asks the gunslinger, what's your name? And the gunslinger replies, walk away, boy. The young gang member insulted says, what? Why, you damned old son of a bitch? You think you can tell me to? But the gunslinger just stares the young guy down. And the young guy starts getting nervous. He looks at his fellow gang members, and he feels that they are encouraging him to take things further and maybe reach for his pistol. So he starts going for it slowly, but the gunslinger, he grabs his pistol and blasts the young guy in the head, killing him. All of a sudden, the corrupt preacher traveling with Gumbo McCready, he remembers where he saw this gunslinger before. During the Civil War, he says, I seen him at Gettysburg. He was like a demon, must have killed 3 dozen Yankees by his own damn self. Eventually, the sheriff came to investigate the boy's death, but when the sheriff came, Gumbo McCready's men, they swore blind that it was self-defense. Yes, that young fool threatened the gentleman. No, he hadn't been their comrade, he was just riding with them. The sheriff, he took the hint that Gumbo McCready and his men didn't want to pursue this any further and were not going to change their story, so he crawled back to his bottle and left it alone. Now once the sheriff leaves, the gunslinger tells the man that he regrets the boy's death. And Gumbo McCready replies, sure, sure you do. Sometimes though, a man will need killing and there ain't nothing you can do but oblige him. I know. I've killed 30 odd men in my time, had to, just like you did. It's the only thing that sets us apart as harder men, ain't it? Gumbo McCready at your service. So Gumbo McCready introduces himself and his gang, and the saint says, I would have just scared the boy off if you all had not shamed him into reaching for his pistol. Now the corrupt preacher, he doesn't want to dwell on the dead boy. And Gumbo McCready says that they're riding down to Mexico and they'd be glad to have the gunslinger ride with them. The gunslinger, he just leaves though, not answering. And Gumbo takes it as a personal insult and says to his comrades, "He thinks he's too good to ride with me." Now outside the saloon, the gunslinger watched the gang leave before him. Then the gunslinger got the medicine he needed for his family from the doctor, and he began to head his way back home. On his way home, the gunslinger came across a crashed wagon with some innocent people that were killed. He sees that Gumbo McCready and his men did the slaughtering of these innocent people, and they are celebrating, drinking, having sex with one of the dead woman's corpses, etc. The gunslinger can't let this stand, though, so he attacks McCready's men, shooting many of them, cutting down the gang's numbers sharply. Gumbo and his gang fire back. They don't think they are going to be able to kill the gunslinger, though, so Gumbo, he gives the order to kill all the other horses in the area and then mount up and they'll leave, stranding the gunslinger here in the blizzard with no horse. So they do so. They kill all the horses and take off. The gunslinger continues firing at them for a bit, but eventually Gumbo and his men all get away. The gunslinger, he went looking for any survivors, but they were all too far gone to make it, so he had to put them out of their misery. The gunslinger then cut meat from the dead horses and started walking the rest of the way home to his family. It took him nearly 2 weeks, though, to finally get home. Not the 1 week he initially planned on. And when he returned home, he was too late. His wife and daughter were already dead, and the crows had already started picking at their flesh as well. Now the gunslinger wanted revenge on the man who delayed his journey home, Gumbo McCready, as well as his various compatriots. So the gunslinger buried his wife and daughter, and then he went back out into the storm, hunting for his revenge, heading back to the small town of Ratwater. As the gunslinger was on his way back to Ratwater, he ran into another man traveling on a horse. The man explains that Gumbo McCready and his men have taken over the town. They killed the sheriff, and no one wants to stand up to them. Then some of the badder folks in town have even threw in with them now. Now we see in the town saloon in Ratwater, Gumbo is now wearing the sheriff's badge and is enjoying his place of prominence. There is a dead guy in the saloon that's apparently been lying there for 2 days, and Gumbo is leaving him there as a warning of what happens to any man that spills whiskey on his boots. Through conversation, we learn that Gumbo and his gang are holding up in town, waiting out the blizzard. Gumbo, he still wants to go after the gunslinger though, and get his revenge. His associates think that is not such a good idea. Now the gunslinger, he arrives in town, and he yells out to Gumbo McCready, "McCready, I'm here to kill you, you son of a bitch. You and that drunken preacher both, and any man that stands with you, or otherwise gets in my way, it makes no odds to me. I'll send you all to hell." The gunslinger begins charging on his horse and attacking. The gunslinger is brandishing a sword and firing his pistol and takes several men down. He decapitates one with his sword, he's dodging gunfire, and the gunslinger rides right through the bar door, destroying it. The gunslinger then gets off his horse and using his sword makes quick work of the people inside. Gumbo goes to shoot the gunslinger, but the gunslinger just slices off Gumbo's hand. The gunslinger then stabs another man in the eye to a nearby pillar, but his sword then breaks. The gunslinger continues blasting away at all the other men. Now Gumbo McCready grabs the innocent barmaid and uses her as a hostage and human shield. And Gumbo tells the gunslinger, "Shoot and you'll kill her, you bastard. You leave me be or I'll cut her throat out." Now Gumbo McCready accounted on the gunslinger being a good man and not wanting to kill an innocent. But he was wrong. The gunslinger was so blinded by his need for revenge, he shoots the barmaid right into her forehead, And this was the first moment the gunslinger spilled innocent blood. That was the moment that he damned his soul. The gunslinger then goes to shoot MacReady, but his gun jams. He can't believe it. And just then, one of MacReady's associates, the drunk, corrupt preacher, he hits the gunslinger with a shovel in his head, knocking him out. The gunslinger falls down, and Gumbo grabs the shovel and stabs the gunslinger right through his chest with it. And this would end up killing the gunslinger, and his soul would go to the only place it could go, straight to hell. But before he died, the gunslinger's last thought was a prayer, a plea to anyone who would grant it, that he might live 1 minute longer, just long enough for two more murders, for these villains whose lives were a cancer in his heart and he needed so badly to kill. But who could have heard such a prayer from such a man as him? Saint of Killers number 3. The gunslinger, now dead, was sent to hell. Normally when a soul gets to hell, the horror of their condition blasts away everything human from them. All love, all fear, and hate evaporated in the heart of the inferno. Nothing human survived the approach to the gates. But not for the gunslinger. His hate remained intact. Now we see the devil and the angel of death are playing cards down in hell. The angel of death talks about all the world wars planned for the future. The angel of death admits, though, he didn't really want to be the angel of death. He was just a normal angel for a long time before the mortals showed up. But then God created sentient life, and all of a sudden all the angels got jobs. You're the angel of mourning, you're the angel of storms, and you, at the back, you're the angel of death. He didn't sign up for it. The angel of death explains, all I'm saying is, there was a time when I was just an angel and I knew nothing of death or dying. I wouldn't even be feeling like this if I'd been an angel of death from the start. We see the gunslinger riding his horse through hell, all these souls being devoured around him. One of the demons touches his shoulder, but when the gunslinger looks at the demon backs off. The gunslinger continues riding, and all of a sudden, the flames of hell slowly start diminishing and become extinguished by cold and snow. The devil senses something is off. He looks out of his tower and says, "The fires are out! How did that happen? What is he gonna do?" So he goes to search what is wrong with his kingdom. Everything was screeching to a halt in hell. The devil finally came across the gunslinger and asks him, "Hey, who do you think you are?" And the gunslinger just shoots a mean look back. And the devil says, "Do you know what you've done? You've put the fires of hell out. You've crippled the place." And the gunslinger responds, "And who might you be?" The devil punches the gunslinger back and yells at him, saying, "Who might I be? I am the king of hell, and I will eat your bastard heart." The devil reaches into the gunslinger's chest to pull out his heart, but the gunslinger's heart is too cold. The cold soul of the dead gunman has frozen all of hell. The gunslinger's hate in his heart is causing this. The devil tries to beat the hate out of him. The gunslinger was whipped to the bone, but he didn't give up. His hate remained, cold and untouchable and absolute. The devil asks, "Why can't you stop hating?" And the gunslinger replies, "Mind telling me how?" And the devil responds, "How the hell would I know?" The angel of death arrives, and the devil is saddened. He says, "Leave me alone. I can't drive the hatred from this bastard's heart any more than I could climb to sit on heaven's throne. It's all over. I'm beaten." The angel of death talks to the gunslinger and asks him why he keeps every last drop of venom and malevolence in him. The gunslinger explains he had something taken from him, his wife and kid, the only good in a bad life. And when it was gone, all that was left was to fall back on the bad. And when he died with work still needing to be done. The angel asks, "You mean killing? And killing's all you wish to do?" And the gunslinger replies, "Yeah." He still needs to get his revenge on Gumbo MacReady and the remaining gang members. The Angel of Death then proposed a deal. The Angel of Death, who was none too happy with his job, offered his position. The dead gunslinger would be allowed to kill the people that he needed to kill in Texas, but in exchange, the dead gunslinger would take his place, bringing death at God's will. The angel says, "You would become the Deathbringer. You would be the patron saint of slaughter and assassination. You would kill for the Lord and in his name, and none but he would have power to command you. Will you do it?" And the gunslinger says he will. Saint of Killers, number 4, the final issue in the Saint of Killers mini-series. The Angel of Death gave up his sword, and it was melted down in the last fires that burned in hell. And from the sword's steel, the devil forged a pair of Colt revolvers. These guns would not miss fire, nor would their hammers fall on empty chambers. No shot they fired would miss its mark, and no wound they gave would be anything but fatal. The Lord of Hell stitched up the gunslinger's wounds, inexpertly, mind you, and the dead gunslinger was given new clothes and a new title. The newly christened Saint of Killers was given his guns, and the Angel of Death tells him, "When your business back in Texas is concluded, you will go to Boot Hill, where a place has been prepared for you, and you will sleep beneath the earth, but your shade will walk its surface, and you will gather the souls of the dead wherever men die by violent means. Time might come when the Lord will send a messenger to wake you, that you yourself can go abroad and kill as he commands. Do you understand?" And the saint replies, "I reckon so." The Saint of Killers starts walking out of hell, and as he is leaving, the devil says, "Yes, good riddance, you cold-hearted son of a bitch." And the saint looks back, though, and the devil cowers, worrying he offended the saint. And the saint grabs his new guns and shoots the devil in the head, killing him, his first victim, the devil himself. The Angel of Death says, "Are you out of your mind? Can you even begin to conceive what this means? You can't do that. You can't kill the devil." And the saint readies his guns, aiming at the angel. And the angel changes his tune and says, "Please forgive me, O Saint of Killers. I should have held my tongue. I know you can do anything you want." So the saint leaves hell, and he returns to the town of Ratwater, where Gumbo McCready and his main companion, the corrupt preacher, were still in Cooley's saloon, waiting out the storm. Gumbo has kept the gunslinger's corpse in the saloon this entire time, celebrating his victory over the gunslinger, pissing on the gunslinger's dead corpse. The Saint of Killers, though, now rides into town. The Saint of Killers is here to kill Gumbo McCready and that corrupt preacher and anyone who traveled with them, but he ended up not stopping there. He ended up deciding to kill everyone. Everyone in town. Every man, woman, and child of Ratwater. And they all died under his guns that night. Innocent or guilty made no difference. He was the bringer of death, and he didn't much care whose. The entire town tried to fight back, but it was no use. They filled their shotguns and took their shots, but the saint killed them all, and the town burned around him. As the saint blasted through everyone, he saves Gumbo McCready for last. And Gumbo yells, "I know you! I know what you are! We killed you! But you took my hand and made me sick, and now I'm just seeing things! You ain't even here! You're a vision!" But the saint blasts through Gumbo McCready, and Gumbo goes flying back, his insides blasting out of his back. Gumbo, now lying in the cold, snowy ground, says, "I know you, goddamn you! You're the devil himself!" And the saint, cocking his gun, says, "There ain't worse than me in all of hell. Go and look." As he blasts McCready in the head, killing him. The saint then went to Boot Hill and slept, until the Lord needed him. He walked the world as a spirit and gathered souls as he'd been told, and he had a busy century ahead of him. Alright, the next story in this volume is the one-shot special called The Story of You Know Who, And this is all about Eugene or Assface's origin. So we see Eugene sitting on a bench, and this homeless guy beside him vomits all over himself when he sees Eugene's disgusting appearance. The homeless guy asks Eugene what happened to him, and Eugene then explains his tale. Part 1, A Day in the Life. Eugene is just a normal teenager. He loves Nirvana, has pictures of Kurt Cobain, his hero, all over his room. He also likes wanking it to a good porno mag sometimes. Eugene's mom is Martha, an alcoholic. Eugene's dad is an abrasive asshole who also happens to be the town sheriff, Sheriff Hugo Root. At some school, some bullies beat up Eugene because Eugene's dad, Sheriff Root, confiscated their drugs and flushed them down the toilet. He also beat on them a bit, so they were gonna beat on Eugene as revenge. Eugene, he spends his entire class daydreaming about the girl that sits in front of him named Laurel Glanton. The teacher eventually calls Eugene out on his daydreaming and embarrasses him. After class in the hallway, Eugene talks to his best friend nicknamed Pube. Pube invites Eugene to come over and smoke some pot after Eugene's done getting his ass kicked by his dad. At home, Eugene's dad does give him a good beating, telling Eugene to get his act together. Eugene then goes and hangs out with his friend Pube and smokes some pot while Pube practices on his guitar, spouting how much he loves Kurt Cobain. When Eugene heads back home to go to bed, from his bedroom, he sees his dad out in the backyard shooting a shotgun into the sky and cursing the aliens that he just knows are out there. Eugene grabs a porno mag and goes for a wank, and then goes to bed. Part 2, Rebel Rebel. Eugene goes to the adult bookstore and buys some more magazines, and as he leaves the store, he sees that girl Laurel from school that he has a crush on. He tries to strike up some conversation with her, but Eugene's friend Pube walks by and embarrasses Eugene, asking him if he got the latest volume of this particular porno mag. Remember everyone, this was the mid-90s, internet porn was not as prevalent as it is today. So Laurel, she leaves, kind of creeped out. Eugene is a little bit upset with his friend Pube for messing up his game. The two discuss their plans to see a particular band in concert that night. We see Eugene's mom is at the local church. She's very depressed, and afterwards she decides to talk with the Reverend. And she confides that her life is so horrible. Her son is not doing well in school, and her husband is just drinking more and more and hates his job and won't talk to me about it. The Reverend tells her, no matter how bad things have got for you, no matter how worthless you feel, or how bad your family has gotten, Jesus has stayed with you. And that's how Jesus rewards you, Martha. He said come and you came, and he never gave up on you, and that's what'll help you get by. And Martha asks, get better? Help my life get better? And the Reverend says, no, get by. Not gonna help your life get better, but you know, get by. She then goes to the local liquor store and buys herself a nice big bottle of vodka. At night, Pube and Eugene are hanging out, talking music, smoking pot. Eventually, this dog comes by and starts yipping at them both. Pube is annoyed. He says he wants to kill that dog, get himself a gun, and blow the dude away. And Eugene asks, where are you gonna get a gun? And Pube says, what about your dad's gun, dude? The one that he's always shooting up into the sky at the aliens and gets drunk and passes out beside? Eugene does not want to steal his dad's gun. Later that night, when Eugene does get home, his dad and him exchange some words. Eugene says he's going to a concert tonight, and Eugene's dad says that Eugene better not be going to see some black music. Eugene says no. Eugene's dad tells him not do drugs, or he'll hit him so hard he'll be pissing blood when he's 50. And then he smacks Eugene around a bit. Eugene, he goes to the concert and decides to crowd dive, but everyone just moves out of the way, and Eugene ends up messing up his face and blood starts coming down his nose. After the concert, Pube and Eugene are talking, and Pube tells Eugene that his grandma's moving to a rest home end of the week, and he figures Eugene should come move in with him. Pube says his mom is always in detox, so she ain't gonna be too much trouble. Eugene says that's mighty cool of Pube to offer. And Pube says, yeah, no problem. So, how about we go get your dad's shotgun and blow that frickin' dog in half? And Eugene, he's not feeling this idea. He says, tell me you're kidding. And Pube says, why you gotta act like such a pussy, huh? It'll be easy. You'll have it back before your dad wakes up. Come on, just imagine that frickin' dog exploding. Yip, yip, yip. Boom. Don't mess me up on this, bitch. Eugene is hesitant, but he ends up getting talked into stealing his dad's shotgun. Eugene, he heads home, and he sees his dad is drunk and passed out in the backyard right by his shotgun. So Eugene slowly sneaks over to the shotgun and grabs it. And he brings the gun back to Pube. And Pube finds that little dog and blasts it away. They then go back and hang out at Pube's house a little bit more, do some more drugs, and then Eugene eventually returns home. Eugene, though, he vomits a little bit, sick from all the partying he was doing earlier. He goes to return his dad's shotgun, but he notices his dad is no longer passed out on the backyard lawn. Eugene's dad, Hugo Root, is standing right behind him. Part 3, New Horizons. When Eugene wakes up in the morning, it's revealed that he has a black eye from his dad beating on him the night before. Eugene then and there decided he is officially going to take up his friend's offer and move in with him. Eugene tells his mom he's moving out, and he goes and grabs his things. Eugene heads over to Pube's house, but Pube is out for a bit. But apparently Pube's sister, Catherine, is there, just picking up some things for their grandma that recently moved out. Eugene and Catherine get to talking, and Catherine refers to her brother as Craig, and Eugene asks, who's Craig? And she says, that's my brother. Why, what do you call him? And Eugene eventually admits that he calls her brother Pube, and that's his nickname, and this causes Catherine to laugh. They talk some more about how Pube and Eugene became friends, and how Eugene likes how Pube introduced him to Nirvana, and explained what Kurt was actually singing about and really got him into the music. Catherine says that her brother Craig has a certain intensity about him that might be mistaken for maturity, I suppose. She warns Eugene, though, that her brother seems like he knows a lot, but it's all stuff he's read in a book or overheard somewhere. He doesn't really have much experience with people because he used to be chronically shy before he discovered pot, and he was always pissed off because people don't get along with him, and people don't get along with him because he's always pissed off. He's harmless, though, just so long as you take him with a grain of salt. Just then, Eugene's dad bursts through the door. After finding out that Eugene moved out, he grabs Eugene by the hair and is dragging him back home. Catherine tries to defend Eugene, but it is no use. Eugene is brought back to his house and tossed into the wall by his dad and is whipped by his dad's belt. Eugene's mom tries to stop Hugo, but she is just yelled at, and Hugo tells her, get in the kitchen, woman! As Hugo is beating his son, Eugene says, Jesus Christ, what do you want from me? And Hugo replies, what do I want? I hear other fathers talking about their sons and how their kid made quarterback or how this kid's gonna be a doctor. What am I supposed to say about you? Well, let me see now. He messed up in school today, and later when he got home, he messed up some more. Hell, he's probably in his room right now, planning how he's gonna mess up tomorrow. Hugo then sees some marijuana residue on Eugene's shirt, and that really sets him off. He tells his son, now you remember what I said I'd do if I ever caught you smoking that shit? He said earlier that he would hit Eugene so hard he'd still be pissing blood when he's 50. So Hugo starts dragging Eugene away, and while all this is going on, Martha is just drinking some vodka in the kitchen and reading her Bible, trying to get by. Later on, Eugene and Pube are talking on the phone. Eugene is bummed about his interaction with his dad earlier, and he's not really in the mood to talk, and he tells Pube that his dad just put out a cigarette on his arm. Pube is distraught, though. He says, screw that, man. Don't you know what's happened? Oh, man, this is so messed up. And Eugene asks, what is it? And Pube says, I can't believe you haven't heard the news, dude. It's the most messed up thing that ever could have happened. I feel like I'm gonna freaking puke or something. Kurt Cobain just shot himself in the head. Part 4, Never Mind. Eugene and Pew meet, and they walk and talk and reminisce and discuss Kurt Cobain's death. And Pube says, I mean, who would have thought a guy like that would suffer from depression? As they are walking down the street, one of the bullies from their school calls over to Pube and Eugene and begins to mock them by doing an impression, and he says, hey, watch this, who am I? Here we are now, entertain us! Bang! And then he mimics shooting himself in the mouth, just like Kurt Cobain. Pube is furious and charges at the bully, but he just gets punched in the stomach. Pube then pulls out a knife, though, and attempts to escalate things, but instead one of the other bullies picks up Pube's guitar and smashes it over his head. The bullies leave, and Eugene tends to Pube, and Pube says, we gotta get your dad's shotgun. And Eugene says, no way, look, I know he bust your guitar and said that about Kurt, but Pube cuts in. Not for him, you asshole, for us. Pube wants both of them to commit suicide. And Eugene asks why. And Pube says, can you tell me one good reason we got for living? No one likes us. You got nothing to do and zero future around here. And Kurt is gone, man. The one guy who ever cared is gone. So what does that leave us? Your dad beating the living shit out of you? Mutilating you? And your mom's a lousy alcoholic? Why the hell do I gotta ask you this? So they decide to go through with it. Eugene steals his dad's shotgun, and they drink, and Pube says, I'm coming, Kurt, I'm coming. And he puts the shotgun in his mouth and blasts away, and he is dead. And Eugene is shocked. Eugene, he grabs the shotgun himself, but instead of inserting it into his mouth, he just puts it right under his chin. And he also pulls the trigger, but it wasn't at the correct angle to kill him. Eugene doesn't die, and he wakes up in the hospital, and his dad, the first thing he says to him is, should have put it in your mouth, you dumb little shit, and he leaves. Eugene, he stays in that hospital room, recovering for many months. Eventually, at some point, Catherine, Pube's sister, visits Eugene, and she wants to understand what happened, you know? Why did you and Craig do it? And Eugene just writes down on a piece of paper that nobody cared. And Catherine gets angry about this and says, nobody cared? Nobody cared, you stupid little bastard. What do you mean nobody cared? You mean nobody coddled you and wiped your asses for you? Your lives didn't turn out the way you wanted them to? Well, screw you. You and my asshole brother both, you self-obsessed, whiny little shits. I bet you never gave a good goddamn about the pain you'd cause. You say nobody cared about you, but I'll tell you one thing. If you're enough of a prick to take a gun and try to blow your own head off, then you didn't care either. Something about this really resonated with Eugene and kind of gave him a new motivation and perspective on life and made him, in a way, start caring about his life. We see back at Eugene's home, his mother threw away the booze and the pills and the Bible that wasn't helpful to her. And she writes a note and leaves her husband for good. The note reads, Dear Hugo, this is just to say I'm leaving and never coming back. I've been putting up with you and our idiot son for 20 years with nothing but vodka, Valium, and Jesus to keep me going, and I've only just realized I don't need them, I don't need him, and I certainly don't need you. Goodbye forever, Martha. P.S. I lied, 3 inches is below average. And just after that, Eugene returns home, although now he has a new perspective on life, a new positive outlook. And he tells his dad, Boy, sure is great to see you. I know you were too busy to come see me. I guess crime never sleeps, huh? But it's okay. I got a cab from the hospital. I wanted to say how sorry I was for all the trouble I caused, Dad. It was my fault for not taking responsibility for myself. I blamed everyone else when stuff went wrong, but it's all gonna be different now, Dad. We can hang out together, go to ball games, you can take me for my first beer and introduce me to your drinking buddies. I promise you, Dad, I'm gonna be the best son in the whole world. And he goes to hug his dad. Back in the current day, Eugene is talking to that homeless guy, and Eugene explains how his dad was killed by a bad man, and he's gonna kill that bad man and he's hunting him down, and when he finds him, he's gonna take his revenge for what he did to my dad, and he's gonna shoot that man dead with his dad's own gun. The homeless guy replies, "Man, I don't know. I've been sitting here listening to you for 2 freaking hours, and I don't think I understood a freaking word of it." "But what happened to your face, man? What dirty bastards did this to you?" And then Eugene points and says, "Me. I did this to me." And the homeless guy says, "You did this to yourself?" And Eugene replies, "Sure thing." And the homeless guy says, "Well, shit, man, all due respect to that cannon you got there, but you're gonna be the dumbest son of a bitch that ever lived, man." And then Eugene replies, could be. And that is the end of the story of You Know Who. The final one-shot special is called The Good Old Boys. This story is featuring TC and Jody before they got killed by Jesse. This particular story is not an origin story. In fact, I would almost say it is entirely pointless. Let's dive into it, though. Jody and TC are out in the swamps near their home on the Texas-Louisiana border. TC is fishing. He catches a fish and wants to have sex with it, but Jody says they better head on home. We meet 2 new people. The man is named Cal Hicks, a cop on the edge, complete with a drinking problem, a dead partner, and an estranged wife. He rescued this woman, and her name is Tommy Ryder, Tommy with an I. She is a supermodel turned lawyer with a dangerous secret. Tommy was investigating a dangerous international terrorist named Saddam Hopper, and she managed to get a tape conversation which would likely be able to put Saddam Hopper behind bars for the rest of his life. Only, she doesn't know who sent her the tape, but she knows that as long as it is in her possession, she will never be safe. So this Cal and Tommy, they are now stuck in this swamp and have to figure a way out of here. Jumping back over to Jody and TC, as they are walking home, they come across a man named LaChance, who organizes fights in the bayou. The more extreme the fight, the happier he is. Jody is a regular fighter in these bouts. LaChance asks Jody if he wants a turn in the pit today. Jody, he's down for it. He jumps in the pit. Now all the redneck Hicks who are watching the fight all think Jody is going to win because Jody always wins, but they don't know who Jody is going to be fighting today. LaChance says to raise the gate, and in walks Jody's opponent, a literal gorilla. The gorilla roars, and TC is concerned for Jody. LaChance is happy though. His betters will enjoy the fight, and Jody is no longer the odds-on favorite as he usually is. Jody may actually finally lose a fight. We jump over to the international terrorist Saddam Hopper. He is getting some sort of colonic by sexy women in swimsuits. Okay. Saddam is talking to a man on the phone who is leading a team of soldiers in the swamps. They are hunting for Tommy Ryder and this tape recording of incriminating evidence she has on Saddam Hopper. Saddam yells at his men to get that recording or the feds will have a field day with him. Back over to Jody in the fighting pit. TC complains to LaChance that this isn't a fair fight, but LaChance answers, "Ain't nothing in the rules about fair, boy." TC tells Jody the odds are 50-1 against you. Jody doesn't seem scared though. LaChance drops 2 baseball bats into the pit, 1 for each fighter, you know, their weapon, and the fight officially begins. The gorilla picks up the bat. He doesn't seem to really understand what he's supposed to do with it though, or what is going on. Jody picks up the other baseball bat, and he smashes the gorilla in the head with it. The gorilla roars, and Jody then shoves the bat into the gorilla's mouth. Jody then runs over and grabs the other baseball bat. He picks it up and then bashes the gorilla's face in, and the gorilla falls down on the ground. Jody then continues bashing the gorilla over and over and over again until the gorilla eventually dies. TC and all the spectators cheer from the audience as Jody climbs out of the pit victorious. LaChance is kind of concerned that Jody might think he was trying to screw him over. So he says to Jody, "Hey, no hard feelings, man. I knew you could handle that dumb old ape." TC and Jody get their money, and then Jody sodomizes LaChance with the baseball bat. Back over to Cal and Tommy. They are still in the swamp, along with Cal's dog named Doofus. They get spotted by Saddam Hopper's men, who shoot at the two of them. Tommy and Cal hide behind a fallen over tree, but eventually are forced to surrender as they get overwhelmed. As this is all going down, TC and Jody walk on by in the middle of it. Saddam's men asks, "Who the hell are they?" And TC replies, "We're just passing on through." And Saddam Hopper's soldiers say back, "You can't just walk away. Who do you think you're dealing with here?" Jody shoots that guy in the head, and TC shotguns another one. Jody shoots a few more, and TC continues shotgunning away. Eventually, all that is left are Jody, TC, Cal, and Tommy. TC and Jody go to leave, but Tommy tells Cal, "Come on, let's follow them." As they do, TC grabs Tommy and covers her mouth, and Cal trips and falls, but they all stay silent as more of Saddam Hopper's men go by on boats in the swamp and miss the four of them. Cal and Tommy decide to introduce themselves to TC and Jody. Cal says, "I'm Detective Cal Hicks, and this is Miss Tommy Ryder, and I'm gonna need a vehicle and a route to get out of these swamps." And TC replies, "Well, shit, pardon me while I go fetch the frickin' Bentley." Now, Jody tries to hit on this Tommy, and he says to her, "Ain't Tommy a fella's name?" And Tommy replies, "No, it's with an I, you know, Tommy." And Jody says, "Still sounds like a fella's name to me." And Tommy replies, "Well, the I makes it feminine, you know, like Bobby or Jerry or Andy." And then Jody to this says, "Or Butchie or Hanky or Georgie." And then Jody, trying to hit on this Tommy, says, "Well, hell, if a gal's got a sweet ass and a set of titties like yours, I guess she can call herself Steve Mafrickin' Queenie if she wants to." Cal takes offense to Jody's treatment of Tommy. He tells him, "Hey, you can't talk to her like that." And Jody says, "Nope." And Cal replies, "Not as long as I'm around, you can't. And believe me, pal, I'm the last man in the world you want to mess with." Jody, not really feeling intimidated, says, "Well, guess I better not mess with you then, you being such a tough guy and all." They all agree to work together and get out of the swamp. TC says he knows a place they can all rest up for the night, and come morning they can get an early start on going home and maybe reach the road by noon. While Cal and Tommy walk on ahead, TC asks Jody, "Jody, how come you didn't just rip the fool's head off so we can give the other fellas the slip?" And Jody replies, "Look at the way that boy talks, the way he handles himself. He reckons he's a goddamn hero, and heroes is always fun." So Jody's planning on messing with this Cal guy. They all make camp for the night. TC and Tommy are talking, and Cal announces he's gonna go for a walk, and he's trying to get Tommy to go along with him, but for some reason, Tommy seems to be really enthused in TC's conversation. TC, he's talking about being in the country, and how not everyone in the country is as backward or crazy as some people make them out to be. It's just an exaggeration. Living here reminds him of that show The Dukes of Hazzard, except, you know, local folks have sex with their kin a lot more. Tommy comments how different TC and Jody are than the people she's usually used to interacting with. And TC explains that, yeah, he's pretty quick. And Jody over there, he's got superpowers. He's like faster, meaner, tougher, and smarter than anyone he's ever come up against. But really, we ain't so different to most fellas there, honey. Hell, we're just a couple good old boys. Eventually, Tommy meets Cal and they go for a midnight walk. And they attempt to have sex under the stars, but Cal can't seem to get hard. And Tommy eventually grows disappointed and says, "It's been 10 minutes. Jesus, why am I even doing this? I must be drunk. I'm not even attracted to you." And she leaves. As Tommy leaves and returns back to the camp, she walks by Jody, and Jody says, "Nice night," to her. and the two of them share a kind of look, implying that maybe there's some sexual interest between the two of them. Now Cal, he goes by and sits by a log, and for some reason has not pulled up his pants yet. Why isn't he pulling up his pants, people? Anyway, his dog Doofus is there, and Cal says to Doofus, "Hey old buddy, my faithful old pal, you weren't about to run out on me, were ya? Course you aren't. Wanna play fetch?" The dog then takes a dump by Cal and walks away. The dog then walks over to TC, and TC says to the dog, "Nice night." And the two of them share a look, the implied joke being that TC is gonna totally bang that dog. In the morning by the campfire, it's obvious that Jody and Tommy bang during the night, as Jody is kind of low-key making fun of Cal. But Cal doesn't seem to be picking up Jody's signals. We see Saddam Hopper himself has arrived and is leading his men through the swamps on their hunt for Tommy and this tape recording. Jody and TC snatch one of Saddam's men from the boat by lowering a noose and catching it around the soldier's neck. They question the guy, who tells them that Saddam Hopper is here for the girl. Well, Jody and TC, they kill that guy. And TC asks Jody if they're gonna hand over the girl. And Jody says, "Not unless we gotta. Gal so sweet you could use her shit for toothpaste." Remember that line, guys, next time you're looking for a pickup line to say to a girl. Jody and TC climb down from the tree, and Jody and Cal exchange a few more words. Cal gets shit on as the dead hanging guy from the tree lost his bowels when he died, as some people tend to do. Saddam Hopper spots the four of them and turns the boat around. He fires a rocket launcher at them. Jody and TC, though, they disappear into the swamp. The rocket hits the tree. Cal and Tommy, they give themselves up. Saddam's men ask for the tape recording, but TC and Jody were just hiding, and they pop out of the water and kill the soldiers in their boats. And Jody grabs the boat's motor and turns the propeller onto the soldiers, killing a few of them brutally with it. TC and Jody, though, are forced to retreat back into the swamp, as there's just too many of Saddam Hopper's men. Their plan is to finish this at night. At night, Cal and Tommy are tied to a tree, and Saddam Hopper is questioning them, "Where is this tape recording at?" But Tommy says nothing. And when they are alone a bit, Cal tells Tommy that everything will be okay. He doesn't know what Saddam is gonna do to him, but he plans on keeping him occupied long enough for Jody and TC to get here to rescue them. Tommy says she hopes that he can, because Saddam's gonna be pissed when he finds out that she doesn't have his tape recording anymore. She says she was keeping it in her underwear, but it must have fell out when her and Jody had sex last night. Cal, he freezes. Can't believe that Tommy just admitted she had sex with Jody. Tommy says, "Why not?" And Cal says, "Because he loves her." And Tommy replies, "But we only just met." And Cal, he envisioned this whole fantasy of the two of them being together. Tommy's really not into it. Saddam comes back and tortures Cal a bit with a hot knife. Eventually though, while Saddam was being distracted torturing Cal, Jody and TC killed all the rest of Saddam's men. Jody then approaches Saddam with the tape recording in his hand. He has it himself. He offers Saddam a deal. He can take the tape, but he has to leave the gal behind. He adds, "You can have that dumb fella there to cut up some more if you want him." Saddam does not like being threatened though, so he points a gun to Tommy's head. He tries to shoot her, but he's out of bullets. Jody, he then grabs the Saddam and then puts him in a headlock, and then he rips his head clean off Saddam's body. Saddam is dead. In the aftermath, Cal and Jody argue. Cal is pissed at Jody for all the ways that Jody has mistreated him and disrespected him and disrespected Tommy. He challenges Jody to a fight, which he easily loses, because the next scene we see Jody has left Cal tied up in the swamp as food for the alligators. And this story ends, Tommy is with Jody and she has her hands all over him, and Jody tells Cal that his gal's with him now. And Tommy tells Jody, "Jody, you're such a beast." And then we see that TC is with the dog Doofus. Doofus is licking TC's face, and TC says to Cal, "Same goes for your dog, boy." And as they walk away, Cal screams, "I hope you all burn in hell." And shortly after that, he gets eaten by an alligator. The end.
Okay, so that was volume 4. I really enjoyed the Saint of Killers origin story. I felt it was really important for the overall Preacher story to know a little bit about the Saint of Killers. And I thought it was a really compelling story and fun. I love Westerns and I love stuff set in that time period. And I liked seeing the Saint of Killers just killing everybody in this whole confrontation with this Gumbo McCrady and that story with his wife and daughter being sick and having to get medicine for them. I love that all. And then when he died and went to hell, I thought it was funny how all the demons and the devil himself are scared of the Saint of Killers. And the Saint of Killers shot the devil himself. That was a really fun story and the best part of this volume. Now, the Eugene story, the origin of Assface, I didn't enjoy that much. I thought it was kind of depressing. His mom's an alcoholic who runs away. His dad beats him. His best friend is a loser who kills himself and talks Eugene into killing himself. All in all, it was very much a downer. Eugene is supposed to be the comedic relief. And while there was a little bit of comedy, it was mostly just very sad and depressing and not very fun of a read. So I did not love his story in here. Eugene, though, he's going to be coming back a lot more in Preacher Volume 5. So it is nice to get some of his origin fleshed out a bit. But at the same time, you almost don't really need to elaborate more than what they did in Volume 1. So did not love that story. Now, the last story in this volume, The Good Old Boys. Like I said in the beginning of the video, it was a complete waste of time. Not important at all. I would say the overall story is just ridiculous and stupid. This Cal and this Tommy have this tape on this Saddam Hopper, and Saddam Hopper tries to kill them, and like, who cares? None of that matters. And no, I wasn't a big fan of it, but I will say there was a few funny bits in it. I like Jody fighting the gorilla. Just ridiculous. That was funny. And I liked the bit of TC trying to have sex with that dog. And, you know, Jody and him saying, "Nice night." That was funny. Yeah. But no, I did not like that story. All right. I'm going to give this volume a 7.5 out of 10. There's some highs and there's some lows and some in-betweens. Yeah, it was all right though. Thank you all for watching, and I will be back next week with Volume 5.